keep up with another 100 lyrics, you more than got the gist of the song from the music alone. He wasn't just accompanying the singer, he would be right beside the singer in their emotional journey. We worked on many shows together after that in various capacities.
Just thinking about tomorrow.
Thank you. Thank you. Michael is rapt when the first whip comes out. Write your own jokes. 9/28/12, Las Vegas, celebrating my birthday like it was a pop quiz about my various friendships in life. 15 of my closest friends are in attendance. He is my oldest friend there that night and wins an additional $200 gift certificate to the Mandarin Oriental Spa. At dinner the following night, I hear him say with a grin, "Who had the sewer Jeffrey at the spa?" Write your own jokes. 6/8/14, New York City, Michael attends the Tony Awards with my small group of friends as my guest. I watch him watching the ceremony inside Radio City Music Hall. His love for the theater is so evident from the opening number of the Supper Ball at the Plaza. 12/25/17, Singer Island, Florida. Michael, Phoebe, and I have an elaborate Christmas Day brunch with a great water view. This trip was the last time I saw my own mother, who was deteriorating from dementia. Just a 7-minute drive from Michael and Phoebe's apartment. Michael and Phoebe provide great comfort that day. I don't know what I'd do without them. 10/26/17, in an Uber. Michael returns from his trip abroad. He texts me, making plans for his upcoming New York visit. I tell him I'll see him in a couple of days and we'll meet him at my apartment the night he arrives. He texts back, "Definitely, I'm not planning to do much of anything except see Etan on the show." The next day, he is gone. Time is fleeting, precious. 37 years of friendship gone in a flash. I'm left with wonderful memories, and I think about them every day. Like Sheldon, Vegas, LA, DC, Williamstown, and on my almost daily walks between 41st Street and 53rd. I love you, Michael. You are my A-lister.
Spending a month no attempting to be cruel, like we did all year at school.
You're accepted. your thoughts must be, what I'm thinking is that no one loved this night more than Michael Larson. And I really do pray to God that he's listening to this. I wrote, you've all been so funny, and I hope I'm a little funny, but I wrote some words. This rabbi puts up with a really weak mic. I would not stand for it. All right, there you go. As we pan through our lives and fast forward and reverse, it's not always easy to see the faces that are truly rooting us on. It often takes a time like this, a death, a loss, to take a pause and zoom in on the pixelated faces in the crowd. Who was cheering? Who was sneering? Who was hooping and hollering with their arms in the air and screaming, go faster, higher, better, sing out, Louise. Who was there screaming to hit the high notes? Notes you couldn't hit, to nudge your shoulders back, your chin up, and tell you to stare down the audience and give up fear, if only for the length of a simple, sweet song. Who was there to use 6 or 7 stairs in the case on your travels upward towards being so much more than you ever daydreamed you could? And then one day, perhaps you yourself could be 6 or 7 steps for another. Michael Larson was that for me. Michael could yell. I can see him there, chain smoking, pacing, hunched, mad, no furious. I could never get that one note right. Glue bleeds to say, this sweet on chante. That's not it. It's flat, it's sharp, I still don't know the difference. He's absolutely livid. Again. We're at Kutcher's Country Club. We're rehearsing on stage. Kutcher's, where even the spider webs have spider webs. What an odd place for an attempt at perfection to rear its confused crowd. Older than God's great-grandparents will be limping and rolling in any moment to order and then promptly return their soup. Je suis enchanté. That's definitely not it. I don't think I ever quite got it. Although later in that performance, whilst kneeling down the center, a woman well over 135 years old whispered to me mid-song, you're doing a wonderful job. No one I have ever met or would ever meet cares so passionately about making child performers better. A passion so great, it quite literally broke his heart. Michael and I remained friends throughout the years, and when Woody Allen asked me to audition for the musical version of Bullets Over Broadway, I couldn't think of anyone else to call. I mean, there are infinite pianists and singing coaches in Manhattan, of course, but who compared to Michael? I mean, he wouldn't just be coaching and playing for me, he'd be willing on stage. He'd be chanting, go, Zach, go. He put all of his heart, now kept safely within robotic rhythms by the pacemaker tucked neatly inside his chest, into getting us both to Broadway. Care, but care safely, that robot whispered in time to his heart, as his fingers waltzed effortlessly over the keys. I wanted to show you the video tonight, but there was no means here. If you remember, when you go home, you can find the audition on YouTube under my name. I'm singing blue skies shining at me. Nothing but blue skies do I see. And I remember I framed the video at the time to include Michael because I thought my singing was mediocre at best. But I was so taken by the joy in Michael's face as he played, I thought it might distract Woody and Susan Stroman. Like the magician's sleight of hand, from the creaky upper notes of my register, they'd be looking at this joyous man's face. Michael was elated. There we were, so far from an old barn in Lock Shelter, New York. Singing out for Arshot Broadway. What higher goal could there be for us, teacher and student, willing our voices, 32 blocks north to the winds of the St. James, where the chaotic Oklahoma and Helen Dolly had all been muted? Well, Michael was the first person I called until I got it. And neither of us could believe it. Well, that's not exactly true. I couldn't believe it. Michael could. You know, since Michael's death, I've been thinking a lot about how I personally could get back, about how I might one day form a stair or two in the early steps of a child's career. How could I possibly pay what I've been blessed to have happen to me moving forward? Isn't that, after all, what Michael would want? Not solely a plaque that sings, "This is where we began," but an action, a Michael personal change in someone's life that lifts them up, that boosts them higher, like two children intertwining their fingers to help one another over a fence that's too tall to crawl to climb. I don't know if any may have seen this, but a few weeks ago, a video of a young boy from a tiny town called Blairsville, Pennsylvania, singing "She Used to Be Mine" from the musical Waitress with Violin. It has over 4 million views and it's still climbing. Betsy Wolf retweeted it, and Sarah Bareilles retweeted it, and suddenly it was in my phone. There he was, this little 14-year-old boy standing in his gym clothes against a wall, belting with passion and an understanding of heartbreak one couldn't imagine someone so young could possibly comprehend. Nor could you imagine he could sing the 11 o'clock number from a hit show with all the gusto of Jesse Miller and Sarah Bareilles. It was unbelievable. Michael Larson, I thought, would have loved this child. Michael Larson, I thought, would have cried and pooped and hollered and would have said, "Go, Adrian, go!" Michael Larson would have intertwined his fingers and lifted him up over the fence. He would have lifted him over every fence between Blairsville, Pennsylvania and the wings of the St. James Theater. So I tracked him down in Blairsville, Pennsylvania. And I told his mom and his amazing singing teacher, who has all of the qualities that Michael has and had, that it was my humble opinion that this child needed to go to a very special place in upstate New York. And that if Mike was the name, I would pay for it all. Well, all three of them agreed it was a very good idea. I only ask one favor in return, an honor of our teacher and our friend, when Adrian comes singing Michael's honor today. Well, last night, Sarah Bareilles invited him to sing for the audience after the curtain call of Waitress. This child has been in New York 24 hours and has already made his Broadway debut. So, Michael, thank you for lifting me and so many others so much closer to our tiny corners of the infinite sky. And here is my new friend, Adrian Matthew, to stand as she used to be mine from Winters.
for putting that together.
So yeah.
The metaphor of the woods, and the most important line, I'm a witch, you're the world. I'm pleased to bring out my very talented sister, the person who inspired me to get into theater, and the reason I met Michael. Please welcome Julie Green.
Randy spoke so eloquently. Michael was a part of our family and TV. And when I was a kid, he was at everything. And now, I think Michael would be really happy to know that he gets to be a part of my family with my kids. And when I thought about what song I would sing, normally I would go to my little ticket. And I knew it had to be Sandra.
When I think of all the living people
57 years, I am astonished, envious, and completely humbled. He never held a mirror up to anyone. He just was too busy doing. I met Michael in 1985 when he was musical directing an off-Broadway Yiddish English musical called Golden Land. I was cast to replace some actor named Avi Hoffman, who was leaving the show, apparently. The thing was, I didn't really speak Yiddish. It was my parents' private language, which they would speak so that my brother and I wouldn't understand what they were talking about. And yet, I had done enough Jewish-themed musicals, so I understand the flavor, and I certainly knew what it sounded like. Well, Michael put me through my paces, and in 12 short days, I was singing and speaking Yiddish like a true lobster. He convinced me that it was easy. A few years later, when Michael assumed the reins of the legendary stage door manor, he invited me to come up for a day, sit in on a few classes, rehearsals, see a performance that evening. It was astonishing, the amount of activity that Michael oversaw. Once again, in his capable hands, easy. In 2008, we had a really wonderful reunion with Neil Sedaka, a jukebox musical called Breaking Up is Hard to Do, at the Algonquin Playhouse in Maine. I played the resident Catskills comic, Harvey Feldman, and Michael was not only our musical director, but he was also cast as the band leader of the onstage combo. Well, we had a great time doing the show, but nobody had a better time than Michael up there on that stage playing as not only just musical director, but he was actually on stage as a performer, and we all know his enthusiasm. At his suggestion, we co-hosted these elaborate Maine-type lobster dinners, complete with coleslaw and baked potatoes and the fried clams, and we had to do everything for everybody, the whole thing. He wouldn't do anything less. And he charmed his way into getting Renee Taylor, who was starring in the show, to take us on shopping sprees with her husband Joe Bologna in tow. And that was an experience in itself. Michael's dog Gracie and my dog Charlie kept company while we were on stage. And basically it was a fun, memorable summer. We kept in touch on and off through Michael's move to Denver when he was sending out companies of Menopause. And he casually mentioned to me about his heart attack. But Michael, resilient as ever, bounced back. And he even made that look easy. Then he went back to the Big Apple. And he was first living on Wall Street, which I couldn't figure out why he was living on Wall Street. But before I knew it, he had found an apartment in Brooklyn's Metrotech Center, and we were neighbors, which was great. So one day, I get a phone call from Michael, who calmly told me that he was at NYU Medical Center, that he had had a heart episode, and would I mind if I went to his apartment, get his bathrobe and pajamas and some meds, bring it to him in the hospital, and could I also take Gracie for a couple of days? Anything for Michael. And sure enough, I don't know how long he was in the hospital, but before I knew it, he was back picking up Gracie, and everything was good as new. Made it look easy. I don't think Michael knew the meaning of slowing down. When he told me he was moving out of Brooklyn and down to Florida, that's what he intended to do. I know that was not what he did when he got down there, because he was busy as ever, coaching people, musical directing, mentoring, doing what he always did. And he never stopped spreading his unfettered joy of life. Then last October, I was about to go into a birthday party for a director who was celebrating coming in from London, and I was greeted by another friend, Sandy Rosenberg, and the first thing she said to me was, "Did you hear about Michael?" And I knew what she was going to say, but I didn't know what had happened, because I hadn't been on social media and hadn't heard anything. And my heart sunk in anticipation of what I was going to hear, while another part of me just couldn't accept the news. The party that night was over for me. So then I was cast to do a play in Naples, Florida. And instead of getting to play with Michael on my days off, I wound up paying a condolence call to his beloved Phoebe. And we hugged, and we laughed, and we cried. So, through all this, I've been trying to make some sense of Michael's passing, but it hasn't been easy. The only thing that comes to mind is that Michael led by example. He was an insatiable student of theater, of music, of people, and of life. He wasted nothing. He lived every millisecond of his existence the way few of us ever do. Maybe deep down inside he knew that every day was a gift, that his time was limited, and it could all be taken away in a moment. So when all that time finally did come, I like to think he had no regrets, nothing left undone. Even now, he's teaching us, leading by example. Thank you for that, Michael. You made it look easy. But to be honest, I wish you were here with us celebrating. Thank you.
I've never seen a person who has touched so many lives all over the world. I mean, not just in a city or a state or a country. Michael touched lives all over the world, and I believe many more people would have been here tonight if they could have. So, you're the lucky one, Phoebe. You had him all those years, and how lucky you really were, because I know what he meant to us, but you got to be his mom, so how special that really was. I just want to say, I've heard a few people mention Menopause Musical tonight. Every time I hear it, I kind of laugh, because Michael Larson, in the same sentence with Menopause Musical, just makes no sense to me at all. And I'm going to tell you the backstory to Menopause the Musical, and you'll understand why I never forgave Michael for what happened. And this wasn't even part of my story.
He moved and he is still here. I look out into this room. I see him in the gleam in your eyes. His students, his family, his friends. I hear him through the notes that was sung so beautifully by the Allentown Cabaret group. They are his disciples. I know we all remember him with love as we share Michael stories. As Alan mentioned and Taryn mentioned, we met Michael when Taryn was 10 at Stage Dramatic. There was a lot of talent on the stage, but my eyes were on Michael. Who was this guy? I was one of the fortunate parents who he bonded with. We laughed into the wee hours of the dining room, and it was there that our friendship blossomed and grew, and soon it grew into a professional partnership. He was not only Taryn's mentor and dear friend, but he soon became my mentor as well. I became a bit of his sidekick, and he said, "Oh, be my assistant director on this show or that show." And I would watch him, and I would marvel at his talent. But this soon brilliant man, who worshiped the ground that Sondheim walked, was suddenly musically directing and directing a show whose tagline was the hilarious celebration of women and the change. He shared his brilliance with each and every cast member, cast after cast, and I would watch in awe. I learned so much from him. I think maybe my favorite Michael story was when he was musically directing a show that we wouldn't typically produce, but somehow we were drawn to it. It was called Naked Voices. And there we were on South Beach, and I did our little prayer circle before the show, and we gave our traditional robes out to the cast members, and Michael wore his proudly, and he had just survived one of his miracles and some heart surgery. And he walked out onto the stage and sat at that piano bench, and he stood up proudly and dropped his robe. And the craziest part of it all was that as I was watching and maybe even idolizing him a bit, he really cared what I had to say, and I was just a rookie. He took it all in, and then he always asked me for my news. In the past year, since he's left us, I have read the countless tributes, tribute after tribute. I have decided that Michael Larson is the most influential person of our time. Someone once said to me, too bad that he never had children to leave a legacy to. Well, I know we can all differ. He has left a legacy with thousands of children, students, actors, performers, season after season, generation after generation, whose lives have changed for the better because they knew him. I know he lives on in all of us, and in all of the lives that he touched. He's embedded in our hearts. He's embedded deep in my soul. I miss you, Michael. Sometimes I sit as we hire a new actress, and I look at their now director, and I know how they would have benefited from Michael's wisdom and the nuances. And frankly, he found magic in a not-so-perfect show and made it rise. And I see a lot of our menopausal actresses out here tonight. So yes, some of us belong to the stars, and I know that his star still shines brightly. I thank him for the love and the laughter and the sharing of his gift with all of us and with me. And somehow, he was just the right mix of naughty and nice, and perfectly imperfect, and I thank him for that.
I didn't know what stage left was stage right. I didn't know what stage down, stage theater left. I mean, it was just, I learned everything from Michael. And I really, I know that too. I call him my theater guru. Michael was like the Google of theater. I never had to Google anything. I would just pick up the phone or text Michael and say, by the way, you started so-and-so in 1996. And Michael always had the answers. And no matter what situation we were involved in or what show we were evaluating, whether we wanted to produce it or not, I always called Michael, and I always wanted to get his advice and his opinions. And it saddened me when Michael came to the, we did a little memorial like this for our choreographer, who was Michael's partner in crime, and they worked together all over the country, as Karen mentioned before. And I feel like God brought us together one more time that night, because Michael obviously came with Phoebe, and something special happened. It was really strange. We were all together for a couple hours, and Michael spoke profoundly, as only Michael could do. I mean, just always had the right things to say, knew how to say them. And then they left, and we hugged, and we said goodbye, and little did I know I'd go see Michael a month later. He would be gone, but something really strange happened. He calls us about an hour later, and he says, "Oh, please, Michael would do." He says, "You're not going to believe that I left my iPad at your house." And he was already like an hour away, so I said, "No problem, I'll meet you somewhere." So we met halfway, and it was an amazing moment in time. Michael got out of his car, he came and sat in my car, and Phoebe was in their car. And Michael and I talked for almost an hour, and it was an amazing time. Little did I know that I wouldn't see him after that. But it was just beautiful, and I'll never forget that hour we spent together just alone, talking about life and theater and things like that. What happened, Phoebe forgot? I promised Phoebe you sat in the car. She was in the other car. But it was cool out that night, the windows were open. Such a good model, Phoebe. Anyway, and it might just be a real pleasure for the community. I ended by reading the lyrics from a song from Wicked, which really was very meaningful in my relationship with Michael. And I'm not going to read you the lyrics, obviously, but the one line that touched me and will always be with me where Michael's concerned says, "Because I knew you, I have been changed for good." And I just want Michael to know, wherever he may be tonight, he changed my life for the better, and I will never forget him for that.
And Arnie, and then he schlepped me to New Hyde Park, and I choreographed the musical there for a few years, and then we went to Floral Park and a few years over there. And then he said, "Well, no, you've got to come with me to stage door." And so I choreographed among talented people and who I've known my entire life. And then all of his friends, you'd go to a party and you'd meet this one and that one and David and Julia. And just socially, he introduced people and he brought all of these tiny little circles and he brought them all together. We met doing the Golden Land, and then we went to Philadelphia with Michelle, and they put the entire cast in a hotel, except for me and Michael, who they put in a door. And Sasha was there. Do you remember Sasha? Are you still here? So they all went to the hotel after the rehearsals and the performances, and Michael and I went to, like, a bar, and we drank frigid redheads. And while we were there, we designed this piece that I knew from camp. And I said, I really want to do a piece for my act that features you. And so we put this piece together, and I'd like to introduce Michael Friedman, who was supposed to play She Loves Me, Michael's two-hander at The Wig, right? So it's called, with Judith Kleiner. And unfortunately, never got a chance to play with Michael, but instead, tonight he gets to play Michael. He introduced me to so many people. He schlepped me to Florida, and I got to meet the Samuelsons and the Glists and the Kleiners, my beautiful Kleiners. I got to meet all of you people, and I feel so blessed to be here. But I'm here now to think about those frigid redheads and think about a time when we can all be partying together. So we'll all go to play a bit until this is over, right? This is for me.
Oh, Of course, he would always point out proudly that he was 13 days younger than me.
We were somewhat convinced that we were long lost.
And with his dream that he instilled in me, because he saw something in a weird little 14-year-old kid. I didn't know anything more about theater than my 8th grade production of Wizard of Oz, but then he cast me as Jack and Into the Woods at Stage Door, and I couldn't get a single freaking I wish, right? As anyone who's listening to that cast can attest to from the first day, I sucked, but he kept pushing and pushing and threw me into the deep end so that I was forced to grow. And he wasn't just a teacher or a director, he was a partner, he was a collaborator, and he was, you know, sometimes a bit of a dictator. But we loved him because he talked to us not as children, but as colleagues. And his fireworks in the rehearsal room, they made the stakes feel really high, you know, like when he threw a chair. Or when he would, like, storm out of the room and say, "Y'all need to take in an effing movement class." It just made the work feel really important. And watching him play piano was, and I hate to say it in this place, but it was the closest I've come to a religious experience. He really taught me how to express truth through music, what it is to be an artist and not just a performer. And Michael passed away just 2 days before he was supposed to see me in the dance visit. But every night I know that he's watching from up there and probably giving me notes. And he's watching and noting and loving us all because he's our giant in the sky. And in the words of his favorite composer, "Children will listen, Michael. We listened. Thanks to you, we're still listening."
Thank you. To express my feelings in person, I've had many happy and memorable times with Michael, my dear friend and colleague. The high point for both of us was when I dedicated my rendition of Romania, to our mutual friend Bruce Adler, and there were tears of joy in both of our eyes. The last thing I would have imagined was that when Michael played that with me, it was to be our last performance together. Michael was a wonderful, kind, and courageous mensch. And I am so grateful and honored to have had him in my professional and personal life. May his soul be bound up in the bond of eternal life with all my love, Michael Bruce.
Thank you.
when they step off stage after a great performance. Michael Larson. What's in a name? Michael Larson. A rose by any other name. Michael Larson. That's Larson with an E. A name that has evoked a worldwide response of testimonials and gratitude, and unlike anything I've ever seen or imagined possible, a man who touched thousands of lives with his encouragement, his guidance, his support, a man who lived his life to the fullest without compromise, a man who was all heart, and who gave his entire heart and soul to everything and everyone he touched, who treated everyone like a star. And he knew, and he worked with, and helped create plenty of stars. A man who was my dearest friend and confidant for over 30 years. Michael blessed my life professionally and personally, and just last year in Romania, we were making plans for upcoming productions and world premieres, and we had an entire season of shows lined up over a delicious plate of mamalige and caganazzo. How can I possibly summarize all those years of appreciation, trust, and love? And we did love each other with a passion. And although I wasn't his type, and he was not mine, we often propositioned each other. I can't possibly list all the shows we did together and how he made them ever greater. Those of you who have worked with Mike know that every fiber of his being went into his work. His encyclopedic knowledge of musical theater was legendary. His commitment to his work was absolute, and if you were lucky enough to share the stage with him, you knew that he played with his entire body, all heart and soul. And with just a glance, we would understand everything that there was to understand. My one-man shows were actually two-handers. He breathed with me on stage. We harmonized, and we shared our love of theater and our Yiddishkeit, our Jewishness. Being too Jewish will never be the same without him. Michael Larson, a nice Jewish boy, who loved his mother, and he took such good care of her. Michael Larson, a man whose legacy includes not only his work with the greatest performers of our time, not only the hundreds, maybe thousands of productions that he worked on as a director, a musical director, dramaturg, and musician, but whose teaching, coaching, and mentoring of thousands of young theater students has given us some of the brightest stars on Broadway and in Hollywood. A man whose legacy will live forever. A man who obviously continues to inspire. Somebody on Facebook that I don't know posted this for Michael. He said, if life is measured not in the number of years on this earth, but in the profound impact on lives touched, then you, Michael, have lived for centuries. And I would add to that, and you will live forever. I felt that I had to express myself in a song. And so many of the songs that I've sung with Michael over the years were, for me, considered our songs. And then I remembered a production that I did with Michael called Closer Than Ever at the Hollywood Playhouse. And both of our fathers had recently passed away when we started rehearsals. He tried to teach me a song, I'm sure many of you know it, it's called If I Sing. Needless to say, we both broke down in tears for 3 days before we could even get through the song. And at his suggestion, I included it in one of my productions at the Triad here in New York, and we both cried together at every single performance. So I make no promises, but I owe this to my beloved Michael Larson. Zolehobi Alichti Ganil. May he have a very bright, beautiful Garden of Eden, where he is now reunited with his father Reuben, with Theo Mikkel, his beloved Brucey Adler, and his sweet Gracie. He's brought all of us together this evening, and because of him, we will always be closer.
Taught me how every day. Come on.